So in this recording, this introduction to GWAS part two, I'm just going to be covering off some of the things to be more mindful of or specific to GWAS beyond just the what kind of regression model are we running. So one of the key confounders to keep in mind is this idea of population structure and then population stratification. So this is essentially where the allele frequency differs across populations, and so does the trait of interest. So whether you're higher or lower on a continuous trait, or the prevalence of the disease is different across populations. If you happen to then put multiple populations together, then you could end up with false positives, false negatives. I think it's easier to conceptualize this when you think about cases and controls, and this is a little diagram to try and help unpack that a little bit. So what we've got here is we've got two populations, population one on the top, population two on the bottom. We've got cases on the left-hand side and controls on the right-hand side, and the blue circles are indicating an allele frequency. So if you were to simply look at this, then you see that there's more blue on the cases, you would then go, okay, so the allele is associated with being a case. But there's also, if you look at the populations, you've also got more case, you've got more of the allele in population one. So it could be that there is more of this allele in this population, and because of that allele, there are more cases because the allele really is associated with the development of that disease. Or this just might be coincidental. So there might be more, that allele might be more frequent in that population, and for an entirely different reason, we have more cases in that population. And then we've got this complete confounder, which is being picked up essentially because we've not controlled for our population structure and the allele frequencies that are different across these populations. So when we're looking at our case control data, we're really looking for a higher frequency of an allele in a case. If that higher frequency is just there because of the way that the alleles are distributed across the populations, then we're going to get a false positive. The same thing can happen in continuous traits, but it's about where the mean is in that continuous trait. One of the ways that we try to account for population structure and therefore population stratification in our data is by including principal components in our regression models as control variables. So another important consideration with genome-wide association studies is the multiple testing burden. If you're looking at an outcome and you've got hundreds of thousands of individuals that are all being tested at millions of points in the genome, you're going to get associations by chance alone. So we need to control our type 1 error rate. So if you're looking at millions of points in the genome and the exact number of SNPs that you got or variants that you got is going to depend on your imputation panel. But if you're looking at the number of independent tests, so remember, they're correlated. There's linkage disequilibrium across the genome. We want to know how many independent tests there are. Then in Caucasians or European ancestry, it's been estimated to have about 1 million independent tests. Then that will give us a significant threshold to cross using a Bonferroni correction of 5^-8. So 1 × 10^8. So this is the threshold that you need to get across in order to go, hey, there's a significant association here. But that is ancestry specific. So if you're then looking at different ancestries, so linkage disequilibrium, you have more correlated SNPs in Europeans than you do in Africans, for example. So if you're looking at an African sample, and I believe that this here came from the HapMap project, these two populations, then you have an estimation of perhaps 2 million independent SNPs. So consider the ancestry of your sample, have a look for how much correlation there is among those genetic variants that you're testing, and apply the appropriate significance threshold. So the standard genome-wide association significance threshold that's applied is based on a Caucasian sample. Another important consideration is sample size, and do you have enough power to detect an effect with any kind of reliability? So sample size is something that I think we're pretty familiar with now with genome-wide association studies. It's been one of the big reveals of work over the last decade or so. So this is from the schizophrenia working group of the Psychiatric Genetics Consortium, and this is like their early paper with about 9,000 cases and 12,500 controls, which once upon a time seemed like a lot of people, but in genome-wide association studies now it doesn't, basically because of this work that was done. And so with this 2011 paper, there are a couple of points in the genome, a couple of loci that do cross this genome-wide significance threshold in the Manhattan plot. A couple of years later, a lot bigger sample. We've got nearly 37,000 cases, over 100,000 controls. And now we really start to see this genetic signal across the entire genome. And it just more samples, future years, same pattern. You see these towers growing. And with the extra sample size, we expect to have more power and more precision in our estimation of the effect and the nature of the effect on the outcome. So here is just some resources for you in terms of power calculation. You need to be considering what is the expected effect size, what's your sample size. If it's a case control type study, you need to be thinking about the prevalence of the disease, and you need to be considering, you know, what is the minor allele frequency. So just because you have power for some alleles doesn't mean you're going to have power for all alleles, because they themselves are not equally represented in the population. So another important consideration for genome-wide association studies is replication. And this is an important idea for science in general, not just GWAS studies. But are the results that you are finding replicating, are they robust? In GWAS, one method of doing this would be to use meta-analysis and to see that the effect is still significant. Check that the size of the effect is similar, check the direction of effect. Another method is to sometimes take the significant hits and replicate them in another sample. If it's a smaller sample, maybe you're just looking for the direction of effect to be the same. So I've seen this done in a number of different ways. Have a think about it when you're putting together your study, how you're going to show that your findings are relevant, not just to your sample, but beyond. Show that they are robust, show that there's some sort of evidence that it's not just idiosyncratic to your particular paper. And when you're looking at other people's work, have a look at how they're doing that as well. So if you are thinking about genome-wide association studies as an association for a particular locus, and that locus holds correlated alleles, like these alleles are correlated, but they're all representing the same point in the genome that is associated with the outcome, then it could well be that the particular RS number or the genetic variant, that it might switch around when you mix in or add in or change the sample a little bit. But it's still the same. They're all representing something, a change that is the same change in the genome. So this tool here, this link, I find particularly useful to check whether or not if you're going across different studies and different samples and you're looking at the RS, is it really targeting the same locus? And you're looking then not just, gee, is it in high LD, but the direction of effect of your allele, is that allele the same? Is it correlated with the same direction in the other sample or in the meta-analyzed result? So you're not just going, oh, this is significant, but you've got a switched effect direction. You want to make sure that the correlated effect and the correlated alleles are in the same direction on the haplotype. So some of the key findings from GWAS so far is that it is not a single genetic variant that is doing the work or is associated with complex human traits and disease. There are thousands of genetic variants that influence whether or not people are more or less likely to develop various conditions, whether they are more or less likely to be higher or lower on continuous traits. So thousands of genetic variants, each of which has a very small effect size. And because of that, we're going to need huge samples in order to get any kind of precision in the effect of each and any given allele. So one of the other things is that we can look at the genetic effect as a cumulative effect. We have the capacity to calculate polygenic scores, and they are mapping onto whether or not people who are have a higher score versus a lower score might be having a higher score on the continuous trait versus a lower score on the continuous trait, or they might be at more risk of disease versus less risk of disease. So this is just a GWAS checklist covering off the things that have been covered in some of these recorded sessions. We're looking at quality control, making sure that we've got nice clean data, thinking again about our missingness, our minor allele frequency. We're checking our population structure, looking for any systematic differences between cases and controls or across different population groups. We've looked for relatedness in our sample and using appropriate methods to do our analysis to account for non-independence in our individuals. We've considered our sample size and are using a threshold for our minor allele frequency to make sure that we actually really do have enough data for that rarer or less frequent allele, that our regression models will run with that. We've considered replication, so how are we going to show that our results are not idiosyncratic to our sample and our particular study? And thinking always about our interpretation, in that these are tests of indirect association. So be extremely wary of overinterpreting your findings to be meaning something that you haven't necessarily tested.